In this video, we introduce Koine Greek adjectives, not only the forms of those adjectives, but also the syntax and the uses of those adjectives. The good news is that for adjectives, there's not going to be any paradigms for you to memorize. You're focusing all of your memorization energy this week on that definite article paradigm for the last video. So we're first going to go over the basics, the grammatical basics of Greek adjectives and adjectives generally. If you remember back to, you know, second or third grade, an adjective is a word that describes a noun. It gives a little bit more color to the life of a sentence. In Greek, an adjective is always going to agree with a noun that it modifies in person, gender, and a number. So it's gonna match up with the noun that it's describing in person, gender, and number. So two examples here: ha kalos logos. Just one example, ha kalos logos, the good word. In both of these words, kalos and logos are nominative masculine singular. And you'll notice their endings look like one another. That will often be the case, that an adjective's ending will look like the ending of the noun it's modifying, but it will not always be the case. So be aware, and we'll talk about this in a little bit, that there may be discrepancy in the way that the endings of an adjective and a noun look, but that doesn't mean that they do not match in person, gender, and number. An adjective is always going to match the noun that it's modifying in person, gender, and number. Most Greek adjectives are going to have three different inflections or three different endings, one for the masculine, one for the feminine, and one for the neuter. This is the way that the vast majority of adjectives in Koine Greek work. These are called three-termination adjectives because they have three different terminations. That is, three different ways that they end. If the termination is the end, a three-termination adjective is a three-ending adjective. So when you see these in a lexicon or a dictionary, they're going to be presented like this, with the masculine ending on the word, then the feminine ending. So this would be agathe in the feminine and agathon in the neuter. So an example of our a three declination adjective here: hey agathe graphe, the good writing. In this case, agathe in the feminine, and in the nominative and in the singular. But there's another group, a smaller group of Koine Greek adjectives that only have two terminations. They only have two different endings, one for the masculine and the feminine, and one for the neuter. So the masculine and the feminine are combined into the same endings. And these are going to be listed like this in a Greek lexicon or dictionary, with the masculine and feminine together in the sort of head entry, adunitas, and then the second termination or the second ending for the neuter nominative singular noted there with on. So here, this is one of those cases where an adjective's ending is going to look different than the noun it modifies, even though they are in the same case, gender, and number. So hey, adunitas graphe means the impossible writing. And adunitas here, even though it has this os ending that we would often think of as a masculine ending, it's actually feminine in this case, that this is a nominative feminine singular adjective, because of the fact that it's a two-termination adjective and the feminine and the masculine look the same in two-termination adjectives. So what this looks like when we come to adjective forms here, I'm going to give us a couple of different of the paradigms here. These are all also in Black's grammar. This is the endings for consonant, the consonant stem. So you notice that agathos here ends with a theta. And so we have os, ada for the consonant stem in the feminine, and then on in the neuter. And this should look familiar to you. Some of these endings should look familiar to you. So our masculine endings over here and the neuter over here are built on the second declension. So we have swain ionesus, our friend from earlier in the semester, over here. And then the feminine is sort of roughly, we have some differences here in the nominative and the vocative, but associated with our first declension person, asina ionesos. And then over here in the neuter, as always, the neuter nominative, accusative, and vocative are going to be identical to one another. So we have agathon, 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 agatha, and agatha in the plural. So they're identical to one another, and they differ from what is in the nominative. So that rule is always going to stand with respect to the neuter over here. That the nominative, the accusative, and the vocative are always going to look identical to one another in the neuter, and they're going to differ from what the masculine looks like. Then the other stem ending we have for those nouns that end in a epsilon, a iota, or a rho. The endings are going to look like this. So you notice mikra here, this rho ending to the stem. This looks exactly the same as our last paradigm we looked at, as does this side over here. The only difference is up here in the first declension, using all alphas throughout the singular here. So once again, we have swain, ionesus sort of at play as a mnemonic for us, as well as asthina ionesos. And then lastly, a paradigm for our two termination adjectives. These are going to be built on the second declension. So once again, swain, ionesus is here, but we just need to recognize that the feminine and the masculine are together here, that they are not, there's not a separate form for a feminine, but the feminine is incorporated into the endings that we would normally associate with the masculine gender. The next thing we need to talk about here is the uses or the syntax of the adjective. So the adjective in Greek is going to appear sort of in these different forms based on its declension and its inflection for case, gender, and number. But it's also going to appear in relationship with the noun it modifies in different kinds of ways. And there are three different ways that we're going to see the adjective appearing in relationship with the noun it modifies. The first is what is called the attributive adjective in attributive position. The attributive adjective is when the adjective attributes something of the noun. So the good word. The word is the noun and good is attributed to it. In Greek, the attributive adjective is always is either going to have the definite article before it. Usually this is the way you're going to see it appear, something like this, either ha agathos logos, wherein the adjective intervenes between the article and the noun that it's modifying, or ha logos ha agathos, wherein the article still precedes agathos, but this whole adjectival phrase here is in relationship to ha logos. So these both mean the good word. This one, the second one, is a little bit more rare, and it technically means the word, the good one. It's a little bit more sort of a pointed way of specifying which word, namely the word that is good or the good word. And then another way that you'll see the attributive adjective used is if it's if there is no article at all with respect to either the adjective or the noun. So neither, in this case, neither one of these have an article, and this would be a good word. The second use or syntax of the adjective is in the predicate position, a predicate adjective. In the case of the predicate adjective, it is never going to have the definite article before it. So our example here, ha logos agathos, the word is good, so something is being predicated or stated about the word. The word is good, so you can see it here without the article. And then if you Greek can sort of change the word order around. Remember, Greek word order is flexible. So we can have ha logos agathos or agathos ha logos, wherein the adjective precedes the noun that it's modifying and still means the same thing. Again, a slight shade of nuance. Good is the word rather than the word is good. So maybe in this case, the adjective is a little bit more prominent, that it's a little bit stronger than in this case. But in either of these situations, if you come across them in translation, the word is good is a perfectly suitable translation for both. And the last use of the adjective is what's called the substantival adjective. And the substantival adjective will always have a definite article before it, and it will not have a noun associated with it. In the case of the substantival adjective, the adjective is the substance of the noun. It's functioning as the noun. So for this reason, there is no other noun associated with the adjective. So the example here is ha agathos, the good or the good one. In this case, because it's in the nominative, the good or the good one could would function as the subject of the sentence itself. So there's not a different noun that would be the subject, but the good one itself is the subject. Just a little bit more on uses and syntax. This is mostly a point for clarification. We mentioned this a little bit earlier in the video, that an adjective is always going to agree with the noun that it modifies in case, gender, and number. That is always going to be the case, even if it doesn't look like that, even if it doesn't appear that way. So this rule right here does not mean that the adjective's ending will always match the ending of the noun that it's modifying. So we have here the example, the good writing, where an adunitas is a feminine adjective. Even though its ending doesn't match graphe, this is still a feminine ending because this is a two-termination adjective, where in the feminine form his is incorporated with or is the same as the masculine form. Another example over here with mathetein, this is a masculine noun. Remember, there are some masculine nouns that use first declension endings. Those endings that we, first declension that we normally associate with the feminine gender, there are occasions where a masculine noun is in the first declension, and this is one of them. Mathetein is an accusative masculine singular, as the definite article ton over here tells us. And agathon is also an accusative masculine singular. So these match each other in case, gender, and number, even though they don't necessarily look like one another as to their endings. And so what I want to do here, we're going to do a lecture pause. I've given you six different adjectival relationships or different uses of the adjective. What I want you to do is go through each one on your whiteboard and just write whether it is attributive, it's a predicate, or a substantival adjective. And before I give you some answers here, I want you to go ahead and see if you can correct yourself first. So I have given us two of each. Numbers 1 and 4 are attributive. In the case of 1, the definite article precedes the adjective. In the case of 4, it does not. There is no article at all, so we have a good word. Numbers 2 and 6 are substantival adjectives. The good ones, or and specifically because the adjective is feminine here, the good female ones in the case of number 2, and the good one in the masculine in number 6, and then two predicate adjectives in number 3 and in number 5, simply with the position of the adjective agathos switched around in each one. So let's do this again. I've mixed them up, and this time I've taken away the different terms for the different uses. So see if you can once again pause the lecture here and identify what kind or what use of each adjective we have here. And once again, go ahead and do a pause here and do some self-correction. See if you can self-correct before I line them up again. So after they are mixed up, the answers look like this. Number 1 and 6 are attributive. In the case of 1, there is no article at all. A good word. In the case of number 6, the article before the adjective agathos. Numbers 4 and 5 are predicate adjectives, with no article before agathos, but with an article before logos. And then numbers 2 and 3 are our substantival adjectives, where they are functioning as the noun themselves.